We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk. You know you could have been a candle.
I'm holding you so tight. You know you could have been a candle. Hello, how y'all doing? I have been gone for a while, and I am glad to be back on Los Angeles Today on LA Talk Live, reality radio handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. We have a very, very special show for Mental Health Awareness Month. And just because you seek therapy does not mean you're crazy. We've got a very special guest, Mayumi McKinley from Epiphany. And we have Beverly, Pastor Beverly Bam Crawford in the house with a Women's Empowerment Symposium in San Diego. And it's going down.
Glad to be here.
Yeah, we got some beautiful ladies in the house. We're going to really do the thing on this Friday. And so, Mayumi, tell us a little bit about how you got into mental health and how you became a psychotherapist. And
okay, great. Well, I actually thought I was going to be a radiologist. I was like, oh, I'm going to school. I'm just going to look at bones and get paid, and that's that's it.
Right.
But I've always had a passion for understanding why people behave the way they do, just from experiences I had with my own family, from friends I associated with in college, and people suffering with depression, anxiety. And so I decided to study psychology, and after taking a couple classes, I fell in love with it. And my passion, I always had a dream of opening my own practice, and I'm blessed enough to say that that has happened. And had a string of internships, mentors that kind of guided me in the right direction in terms of vulnerable populations to deal with, as far as anxiety, depression, teens that are at risk. I have a passion for working with adolescents, and so several opportunities have come my way for me to be able to work in all these different arenas, schools and mental health facilities, and I'm just kind of living my dream right now in terms of helping people.
And that is a beautiful thing. And Pastor Beverly, you have some experience in mental health too.
Well, I do. And when we talk about living our dream, that's what the conference is about. Dream it, plan it, do it.
But, I saw that.
Yeah, but the company is an integrated women's network, helping women rebuild their lives or to advance their lives or to move further in their lives. In fact, associated with the company, I have what we call ASUBAs. And ASUBA is the word abuse spelled backwards.
Oh.
And one of the thrust of the women's conference and this particular corporation that God had me start is to reverse the cycle of abuse. And that abuse that happens in our families and our neighbors, our communities, our educational system, the racism and sexism and classism,
all
and
the
all
isms.
The things, addictions and all that go with that.
Mm-hmm.
And I have found that in mental health, the spiritual component is really, really paramount. And I believe in working with the Department of Mental Health, they have discovered, too, that spiritual component is absolutely necessary for mental health. I'm a Christian, but whether a person is Muslim or they're Hindu or they're Jewish, whatever their spiritual component is, that's a good place to start with people. Then at one time, mental health did not deal with the spiritual component because it was because of religion. But they found that people's belief, what they believe strongly, has a lot to do with their well-being.
Wow. Absolutely.
There's even research studies that back up kind of what you're saying. Research studies say that people that have some type of foundation, some type of spiritual base, are more likely to be successful in treatment and more likely to have that hope that helps with the whole treatment process.
I could completely agree with you. Mm-hmm. And just to confirm it, we have Open Heart Recovery. And our motto is no drug is stronger than the human spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And our goal is to be spiritually, mentally, physically, and then we get financially fit.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have a holistic approach. So this show just really came together. It's perfect. It's just perfect. I just like, man, God is good.
You're talking about the spiritual aspect, the emotional, social, educational, all of those, and a holistic approach. You have to deal with all of it. And sometimes with the church is awakening to that. And sometimes the church is focused on the spiritual aspect or heaven or hell, or when we talk about behavior, do this, don't do that, rather than ministering or trying to meet the needs of that entire person. And I have learned over 45 years, I've been doing this for 45 years, and I didn't know what it was called in terms of the mental health language. I'm beginning to speak.
Well, that's a stigma. That's a stigma in the Irma community.
It has been. And I say there are so many people in our community, in our churches, in our family that have they've not been diagnosed or they've been underdiagnosed. That some need to be on medication, they need to be in treatment, they need to be in therapy. But a lot of times we have backed away from that because we don't want people telling us that we're crazy. And that's something that's
I'm not going to see the crazy doctor.
No, right. No, or why am I going to tell somebody I don't want people telling me what to do with my life.
Exactly. I'm not going to tell anybody my business, but you're on Facebook telling everybody your business. I look at Facebook, I said, she needs to be in therapy. All of them need to be in therapy. Okay.
Right, right. And I mean, I want to add on to what you say, just the stigma associated with it. I have a lot of people come into my office and some people feel that if they seek treatment, then that means they're not having faith, not recognizing that all these, you know, God gives us therapists, he gives us doctors, he gives us, you know, all of these things.
Absolutely.
But a lot of people will come in and say, well, I didn't want to come because I thought it would mean I'm not being faithful.
Right. And I think that's error in teaching and sharing with people. Faith without works is dead. And so therefore, you believe God, but at the same time you believe in God, you still go take care of the cold. You still, you know, do the things that are necessary to do if it's in your physical body.
Faith without
works.
It's
in your mental.
Works.
That's right. If it's your mental being, we have to change the way people think. And I know when they say, well, if I had more faith, and I've heard people say, well, if you had enough faith, you wouldn't need that. And I don't agree with that. No. Mm-hmm. I believe that we all have the same measure of faith, and then there are different levels and degrees of exposure, and I think that we have to teach differently. So within our congregation and the churches that I'm associated with, we have support groups, we have mental health seminars, we deal with it. In fact, I wrote a book called The Power of the Soul. The Power of the Soul is the authority of thought control, and thought control in terms of dealing with our thoughts and our memories and all that type of thing that have to do with mental wellness. So my whole ministry has been about mental wellness.
Wow. Absolutely. This all came together. So, Mayumi, you went to school are you from Louisiana?
I am from Louisiana. Yes. So, I went to undergrad at Xavier University in New Orleans, and then I relocated to California and got my master's from California State University, Dominguez.
That's Hills, right.
And so,
Dominguez in the house. Charles. So tell us some of the challenges coming here from Louisiana and having to get your master's and get your own business set up, talk to the people. Tell them what that was.
Some of the challenges.
Yeah, because it's challenging.
It is challenging, and I up and decided to leave Louisiana just like I'm moving to Miami, New York, or L.A. I'm getting out of here. Mm-hmm. And so I just up and left. And so one of the challenges was I don't have much family here. And so not having that support system, you definitely recognize how important family is, even if it's just, oh, can you help? You know, can you come out for dinner? Or, you know, hey, can I stop by your house? Like, I really realized even more so, because my family is really close-knit and have a large family, how important those small interactions were, even just the fact that I could go to your house for dinner or stop by you. So that was one of the challenges that I faced. I mean, I've been here about 15 years now, so it all worked out, but that was one of the challenges I did face in terms of just doing things on my own without having my family here physically. That was a challenge. As far as breaking into the mental health field, I have been very blessed in the sense that the people that God brought into my life, just my mentors and different people that I've met along the way, have really paved this path for me. If I sit back and think about it, a lot of the opportunities that were presented to me just coming here not knowing anyone, I've been truly, truly, truly blessed. In the mental health field, it's women dominated kind of. There's not many male therapists, and there's not many male therapists of color. And so and there's not many black therapists that are in private practice. A lot of people who are African-American therapists, a lot of us go to, which nothing's wrong with. There's a lot in DCFS and Department of Health and those things, you know. And a lot of people think social work is all about taking the kids from their families and things like that. People don't realize that there's a large mental health. And so I've been blessed in the sense of being one of not very many black therapist. And so that's kind of paved the way for me in terms of people are you look for people who look like you. Mm-hmm. You know, when you're coming to therapy, and so it definitely makes a difference. I think the stigma is what I'm, you know, faced with people not want.
Well, I'm trying to help you with that.
Okay. I know, and you are. When I talked to a mutual friend of ours, Cheryl, mm-hmm. which is friends of all three of ours, yes, actually, she's friends of all three of ours, and she told me about what you were doing in mental health, mm-hmm. and I thought about the show that we were doing. Mm-hmm. You know, I started to think about questions and how we could tie it all in together. And I saw this coming together the way it is right now. And Mayumi, you have a practice in San Pedro. And I had the pleasure of going out there and seeing her practice and seeing how she has it all laid out. It's beautiful. Mm-hmm. But the conversation we had was that most of her clients are not Black.
No, most of my clientele right now is not, which all of us need mental health, but just is definitely a representation of what we're talking about in terms mm-hmm. of the stigma associated. And then the clients that I do have come in, I mean, I've had clients come and afterwards be like, oh, this is what therapy is? Mm-hmm. Oh, I thought that. I'm like, yes, it's not what you see on TV. It's not sterile walls and, you know, right. you're crazy, people screaming in the hallways. I mean...
So for
I've had a little bit of that.
Yeah, exactly.
I probably have it from A to Z. When I say screaming in the hallway, screaming in the sanctuary, screaming in the parking lot, throwing your box cutter on top of the roof, you know what I mean? Having security to get people, because the church I always consider as first responders. Mm-hmm. Because people come
that's
to church
the first line
when
of
they're
defense.
Hurting. That mm-hmm. when they're hurting, when they're confused, when they're high, when they're drunk, whatever, some of them feel strong enough, you know what I mean, to come to church. And I get them right there at the altar on Sundays, and I will contact her once we leave the show. Mm. But I have been fortunate also to within the congregation to look within the congregation and look at the resources within the church. So we have clinical psychologists, psychotherapists, psychologists, teachers, you know, drug counselors, you know, within the congregation. And most churches have the resources right there within their congregation. If we pull that congregation, and that's what I do.
We need to get the information out there.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And then what I do when they come to the altar and there's addiction, there's molestation, there's rape, there's trauma after divorce, there's trauma, period, just out of racism, all that's going on with Black Lives Matter and all that, I'm blessed to be able to call on people right then and there out of the congregation. Dr. So-and-so, can you see this? Blah, blah, blah. Can you see this person? And so we do
that
what we call
wonderful.
Alter a pastoral care. Mm-hmm. And I just believe that's what Jesus wanted us to do. Mm-hmm. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me. Mm-hmm. And everything he said he was anointed for, the priest for gospel to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, those are all emotional conditions, to give sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free. And mm-hmm. that's what mental health, mental disease is. It's a type of oppression.
Exactly. So what I want you guys both to expound a little bit on is the advantages of coming and getting therapy and getting diagnosed, because we, as we both know, a lot of our people in our community are dual diagnosis. They have substance abuse problems and they have mental health problems. And so I pose this question to you first, Pastor Beverly. What are some of the advantages of coming and seeking help and letting the stigmatism go and not letting that hold you back?
About 20 years ago, we started having support mental health support groups within our congregation. And NAMI was not a recognized organization on the West Coast. In fact, there was no NAMI Urban LA. There was no NAMI LA. NAMI actually started in my church as NAMI Inglewood and then branched on to be part of the national organization.
Oh, wow.
And so with that in mind, we have continued to bridge that gap through community activism, getting involved in everything, not just mental health, but on all levels of education and addiction to help people come to grips with the reality of that. And so I have a friend, a couple of dear friends that have children. They both are double diagnosed with addiction to alcohol. One is alcohol and diagnosed schizophrenia, and another is drugs diagnosed, you know, paranoid schizophrenia. Mm-hmm. And it's tough. And the thing is that when you have to become their guardian, per se, when they have to go in and become their conservator to help, because you can't violate their rights. If they're an adult, you cannot violate their rights. You may mm-hmm. do a 5150, but that doesn't last. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to, you can't violate their rights. And a lot of times they don't want the help because they don't recognize that they need the help. Mm-hmm. And so I think relationship and family, as she was saying, is so important to have a meeting, family meetings, but the family has to get involved. If the family doesn't get involved, then that's when we find our loved ones just lost out on the street. And then mm-hmm. they're misunderstood because they do have a condition, but a lot of times what people first see is the addiction before they see the condition, you know. Mm-hmm. And so I believe that wow. we just have to be mm-hmm. more sensitive and say, but for the grace of God, there go I. I'm not an alcoholic, you know, but I, when I was 13, I was drinking on street corners. I could have been one. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? My sister became an alcoholic. I didn't, but I was drinking when I was 13 or 14 years old. And by the grace of God, I later on didn't like the taste of it, you know. But going through a lot of trauma in your childhood, because I work with a lot of youth as well. So going through trauma in your childhood, and I have an organization that I started called Dreams, and it's Drug Rehabilitative Education. Drug Rehabilitative Education. I got to remember all my acronyms. For teenagers, because right now it's drinking is very popular with mm-hmm. teenagers, but they have a lot of unresolved issues, family issues, because that family of origin, it's so important mm-hmm. to that child's
well-being. They self-medicate.
Mm-hmm. They self-medicate.
So would you say some of the advantages of having family support and getting together would basically take the stigmatism away and make them feel comfortable with coming to get treatment? Because that's a big problem in our community.
I think that's a big step forward. Okay, and sometimes the family, hopefully it is your biological family, but sometimes it may be your extended church family. Because I know we have dealt in a lot of situations, and we call the family because we have certain protocols built within our infrastructure. Okay, if we're going to help or minister to someone, we do contact their family. You know, you don't want to go do anything without contact their family. But it's a little bit a disappointing sometimes when sometimes those bridges have been burnt. You know, either through alcohol or drugs or, mm-hmm. or just family confusion, and they don't want to have anything to do with it. So there are times that we have to be, the church has to be the extended family. And I think the more of us that get involved, we become the voice of reason. We become the voice of humanity for people that need help. And then if I can tell people myself, well, then I took my family into therapy. So people look at me as this, mm-hmm. you know, God's woman of faith and power, but I did. My family, we went into therapy, family therapy, because there were some issues that we weren't able to resolve on our own. And as much as I counsel, I wasn't able. It's like physician, heal thyself. I wasn't able to do it. And so we went into therapy.
You went to go seek professional help.
We went in, and I don't mind telling people that. We mm-hmm. sought it. And I talk about it. I integrate it in almost every message that I teach, because I believe that if you read and study the Bible, a lot of people don't like the Bible, but I love the Bible, that Jesus is the greatest therapist. And so everything in there is telling us, cast our care upon him. He doesn't want us to be anxiety, be anxious for nothing. He doesn't want us anxiety and stress and depression. He says, finally, my brethren, think on these things. He tells us how to control our thoughts. He says, let not your heart be troubled, neither be afraid. He deals with fear and anxiety and oppression. Everything Jesus dealt with, other than when we see him with the physical healings, was mental and emotional healing.
Mm-hmm. Basic instructions before leaving Earth.
Absolutely,
right?
Yes.
So, Mayumi, this question is for you. So people have a preconceived notion of how therapy is. So give our LA Talk Live listeners who may have mental health issues in their family, or they may be suffering, give them an idea of what it's like to come into therapy, like from the call to walking through the door, you know, how the whole process can be, so they can see that it's not some old god-off horrible thing.
Oh, no, absolutely not. I think that's the hardest part, though, the first step, like to making that first call or, you know, trying to find a therapist that you feel would be a good fit for you. I first want to comment on the relief, the why go to therapy and the benefits of it.
Right.
And what came up for me is relief, freedom, and peace of mind.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And you can't put a price on that.
You can't put a price on that. Mm-hmm. And so if you want relief, freedom, and peace of mind, the first step would be is to find a therapist. And finding a therapist can be a challenge. You have to find someone that's a good fit. You know, mm-hmm. just because you see one person and you maybe don't like the way they were talking or you didn't feel connected to them, try again. You mm-hmm. really want to find someone that you feel connected to. And there are several websites out there. There's psychologytoday.com where you can go put in your area code. A list of therapists will come up and you mm-hmm. can kind of read through their bios and see which one you feel would be the best fit for you or your family. There's goodtherapy.org. You know, mm-hmm. you can go on. And so once you find the right fit for you, you make that call. They'll take some information from you. And what you can expect the first day is just a lot of information gathering. They will ask questions, you know, what brought you to treatment? What are some of the symptoms you're experiencing? They will ask because a lot of people just lack the understanding. You mentioned the mental health lingo.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So I've had people say, I'll ask, are you depressed? No, absolutely not. And so then when I start asking, there's lack of sleep. There's not really hungry. Or I'm eating too much. There's, mm-hmm. I'm just not interested in doing things. I'm not motivated really. And by the time they finish listing the symptomology, you realize that's the category mm-hmm. for depression or even anxiety. Oh no, I'm never anxious, but you can't sleep at night. Why can't you sleep? Oh, my mind just can't shut my mind off. Mm-hmm. Well, that's
that's why a symptom
of anxiety.
Seek professional help.
Right, you mm-hmm. go seek professional help, and so it's just a lot of information gathering. It's a conversation, mm-hmm. and I encourage people look at therapy. Don't look at it as this horrible taboo and it means that you're weak and it means that you can't handle your own problems and all of that. It's an opportunity to sit in dialogue with someone who's neutral, a neutral party who is unbiased about different things that have happened in your life, and hopefully they may be able to make some connections between some things that you can't see because you're mm-hmm. subjective. You've been through everything. Your mm-hmm. family's subjective. They want the best for you. Mm-hmm. So they're always going to come from a biased point of view, but therapy is an opportunity to discuss situations, traumas, patterns that have you keep finding yourself in the wrong relationship or you keep finding yourself with a certain feeling, and it's an opportunity to discuss that. And so this person can offer you some skills, some tools, some different ways of thinking that will help you move from that. It's freeing. Like every person, when we terminate treatment or therapy is ended, it's just like, oh my God, I never thought I would be here. I thought that grief was never end, you know. Mm-hmm. I had a client who's, you know, she had two loved ones murdered, you know, within a month of each other. And, you know, now she's able to say, I never thought I would see this day where mm-hmm. I'm able to wake up and be happy and live my life without all this drought. And she's like, nobody's ever taken me back there. I'm never going there again. So it's just an opportunity to experience life in a different way.
So that is the beauty of therapy.
Yes.
That is the beauty of therapy. So, Pastor Beverly, I know we're on mental health, but this Women's Empowerment Symposium that you are doing, it's incredible. Some of your guests, you've done this before?
Yeah, this is our sixth annual one. And this is a three-day conference. We usually do a one-day conference. And we focus on one of our, what I call, isubas. You know, in other words, the reversing the cycle of abuse. So one of our isubas, let's say, is Scarlet Thread and women who've overcome difficulty, maybe had bad habits, behaviors, mm-hmm. Drug addiction, eating habits, what have you. So we have all kinds of isubas. And so that is directly connected to mental wellness. Because a lot of times, like she was saying, we as a people, culturally, we cope. And many of our coping mechanisms throw us into denial mm-hmm. because we're not depressed. Yes.
We don't think we're depressed.
We're avoiding those feelings.
Mm. Yes,
we're taught
yes.
to keep pushing. You got to keep going. You got to keep.
We're
going.
Taught that. Mm-hmm. We're taught that you be. And look what we grew up in this country. And mm-hmm. look at us mm-hmm. historically and generationally. And a lot of this is learned behavior.
Mm-hmm. And we never got help for that either.
Mama didn't either.
Yeah.
And Big Mama didn't either.
No. Mm-hmm.
And Big Mama didn't. Exactly. So therefore, that thing has perpetuated down the line. And so we have learn these coping mechanisms, and they could be called coping skills. If we didn't have them, we probably would have lost it a long time ago. Mm-hmm. So I thank God that we have them, but we can't continue this way because we're winding down. And we look at the generation now, all of our kids, most of our young people and our teenagers now, they have experienced death. They experienced terrorism. Mm-hmm. They experienced violence. If you grow up in the African-American community in Chicago, L.A., or any place, you're used to helicopters and gunshots.
You know somebody kids, who died.
Or our kids are supposed to go to school the next day and cope and take an exam, but I don't see any therapists running down there to the school to help them handle the trauma of your neighbor being shot and his body laying on the street for 4 hours uncovered. So we live in a war zone, and we don't seem to think that our children merit the same type of care as a Sandy Hook. But I does, and I don't want to compare like one is any better or worse than the other, but children are children. But
both of them need the same service.
They need
services.
The same type of service.
And I want to add on to what you're saying in terms of it worked for Big Mama, it worked for Grandma, and I think it did. That set of tools of keeping it going, pushing through worked. Mm-hmm. And at different points in our life, different tools work better than others. And I think with the generation we have today, with them being exposed to so much, it was different back in Big Mama's generation. Mm-hmm. You know, the town over may not ever know what happened to you or know what happened at school. And now you live in a situation to where our phones, I mean, how many news reports have we gotten about Trump or anything that happens? It comes straight to your
phone. Right to you.
Kids
information
are
overload.
Overexposed. And so that whole, oh, don't worry about it or ignore that person at school or just move on. I know you said today, keep going, does not work because we're consistently bombarded with all of this information. And so you're right, those skills were perfect for before. Mm-hmm. But in this day and age, we have to be more aware that there's a different set of skills that's needed. Let's add to that. You're absolutely right. In certain situations, you just got to push forward and go through. But consistently doing that, I always give the example of we're kind of like a sponge. And what happens when you fill a sponge up with water? It kind of starts shooting out of all the holes. And it's the same thing with feelings and experiences. If you don't take the time to sift through them, what happens is you're depressed for some reason. You don't know why. You're going off at your husband for some reason. You don't know why. Mm-hmm. You're angry. You can't sleep and you don't know why. And it's just like the water shooting out of every hole. You're too much. It's too much going on and you haven't taken the time to really sift through it.
Mm. See, and part of the plan for the conference, the plan is whether you have a business, you have a career, your endeavors, but also a plan to be free for recovery. Like we have ladies who are coming that we bring in every conference from a residential facility a year for drugs. We have women that have worked through reentry programs. You know, we have women that are just going through cancer, a lot of breast cancer, a lot of treatment. We have a lot of women who are caregivers, and the caregivers are burning out. You know, they themselves need someone to talk to. And so when God gave me the theme for this particular conference, it was the plan, dream it, plan it, do it. And it's if you want to be well, let's talk about a plan for your health. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about a plan and let's take it step by step and day by day. Let's not think that we can throw it the world together and all the ingredients are going to come together automatically. Mm-hmm. They have to be strategic. And that's why I have a strategic globalist, you know, who talks about planning. I have speakers who are attorneys and judges who know how to deal with people planning their life after incarceration or going through court situations or what have you. A young mother that understands what it's like to hide behind the lipstick. In other words, we look great. You know, look at the reality shows. All of those women and women of color are beautiful, fantastic looking, amazing women. But then after you look at the show for a while, you see that those are women are in pain. They are in terrible pain and terrible need of therapy. So when our young girls look at them and this becomes their role models, and then that is perpetuated through the mass media.
A lot of people in media suffering in silence.
Mm-hmm. You know? I had a friend of mine on the way to work today, and she told me that she's going to work, but she's completely depressed. And she goes on and just puts that show and that front on, and she doesn't even know how she gets through every day.
And you have a lot of people that are doing that. I mean, you have 20% of African Americans in particular that report distress of symptoms. But of them, hardly any go to counseling, hardly any go to therapy. And the funny thing is, the higher the person is educated, the less likely they are to go to therapy.
Wow. That is an interesting statistic.
Yeah, so the people who are doing a whole lot, who may have all these degrees, because people have a misconception that, oh, you got it together, you have that degree, you're financially stable.
But that's what we've been sold. We've been sold the American dream.
We've been drinking the Kool-Aid.
If you go to college, and please don't take this the wrong way, you get your degree, then you've arrived. You know, but I learned that when you get there, there's no there.
This was getting real interesting, but we got the cue for the break. This is Mr. Von on Los Angeles today on LA Talk Live, and we are going to go to break for a minute, and we're going to be right back to continue this. It's Mental Health Awareness Month.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Join the pod, 3 p.m. Pacific, each and every Friday for Los Angeles Today. Purple nights and golden days. Ooh, wee, he's so LA.
What up, LA? It's Mr. Von inviting you to join me every Friday, 3 p.m. Pacific, for Los Angeles Today.
Coming live and direct from LA Talk Live. Entertainment, sports, special guests, current events, and the hottest and latest in LA.
World belongs to us.
This is where the twist goes down daily. Boss up with us. Boss up with us each and every Friday on LA Talk Live. You can also catch us on iTunes R&B or check us out live on LATalks.com. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talks Live, and we're more than just talk.
Hello, hello, hello. We are back again with Mental Health Awareness on Los Angeles Today on LA Talk Live. We have Mayumi McKinley and Pastor Beverly Bam Crawford. Oh, this is one of them oldies right here. Tell them about that. We had to keep it mellow today on Mental Health Awareness. We want y'all to stay engaged with this. And so hopefully everybody out there is getting that, getting counseling and getting help is not a bad thing. It can only enhance and make your life better.
Mm-hmm. And I would say that a lot of people ask the question of, when do I know I need counseling? Like, when should I go? And I would tell people when how you feel starts to impact, usually in two arenas. So it starts to impact you at work. It starts to impact you in your relationships. It starts to impact you in the community. Maybe you get in trouble with the law at school. When it's happening in different areas, then it's time to the number one thing I hear people say, they'll come in and just sit there and be like, I don't know what's wrong with me. I just don't feel like myself.
That's when you need help.
Sometimes people don't recognize they need help, and I'm going to go in the area of forgiveness. Mm-hmm. I find that the root of unforgiveness, there's a root of bitterness many times. Mm-hmm. And anything that is unresolved, you go for any length of time, it can become a mental challenge for you. There's a scripture that says the root of bitterness will spring up and trouble you. Mm-hmm. And so I find that a lot of people that have gone through counseling or sought counseling, that sometimes the root was unforgiveness. Mm-hmm. And see, how can you can't look at a
unresolved
person,
bitterness.
Unresolved bitterness.
And a lot of people don't even realize that it's unresolved bitterness. Yeah. You know, they'll have, a lot of people have the attitude of, I can't change it, so why talk about it?
That's just the way I am. I'm a Leo, baby.
And that's why you need professional help. No, for real. You know, we laughing and joking because we keeping it light. But we want our LA Talk Live community and our urban community to really understand the importance of mental health and the importance of getting mental health. Because so as your mind goes, your body and everything else goes.
Yes.
I think with emotions, like, they say, don't let emotions make her decisions. But I always tell ladies and I tell people, your emotions are yours. And I'm going to respect their emotions. But the emotion cannot lead your decisions and choices all the time. Mm-hmm. And so, therefore, you talk about the emotional aspect, toxic thoughts and toxic emotions and that type of thing. And I realize that in counseling, you know, biblical counseling, not clinical counseling, not certified by the state of California, but I have a presbytery and that does counseling, but we do biblical counseling. And I think that we need to be careful as pastors, recognize that when we're out of our lane, okay, because we're not trained like they are trained.
Wow.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
And so there's some things that pastors have to recognize. This is not my field. I need to refer you to my Uma. I need to refer you to Dr. Tracy. I need to refer you to Dr. Nichols. I need to refer you to people. You need a reference. And so I think in pastoral conferences and meetings, we need to be taught how to refer people who come to us for counseling and when to recognize that it's not biblical counseling that really they need. I mean, everybody can understand, handle some biblical counseling, but you need to talk to a professional. Now, I don't consider myself, I'm a professional pastor. I'm a professional teacher, lecturer.
You're professional.
I am, but I'm not a certified.
Right.
Counselor by the state of California. You follow me? I'm not a clinician. And that gives me sometimes an advantage because I'm not a clinician because I don't come the way of clinicians. I come the way of the gut, the heart, you know. So I'm not saying that she doesn't, but we need the Mayumas. We need people who are certified and are trained to deal with people that are going through all kinds of trauma.
Because there is proven educational
techniques. Absolutely. And we have to respect that.
You have to respect it. Yeah. It's like you going in trying to do heart surgery.
Yeah, let me go in trying to do
heart. Exactly.
Are me trying to be a pastor?
Exactly. There you go.
You might be better being a pastor than I would be.
I'm just saying, though.
My sheep would love you.
Yeah. Oh, that's funny.
But I do. I'm glad that you're having this, and we need to have more forums like this. And like hiding, like a young author, she's a young pastor's wife, Maisha. I think part of writing her book, she'll be at our conference.
What's the name of her book?
It's called Behind the
Hiding
Lipstick.
Behind the Lipstick.
No, Behind the Lipstick.
Hiding.
That's me. Sorry, Maisha. Okay. And I have Jamie, who's a nutritionist. See, and all of this is important. So we deal with well-being. So we're dealing with healthy eating and supplements and enzymes and iodine and how to eat properly because there are some foods that trigger certain people a certain way. And so therefore, if you're going to go holistic or with an integrated approach to health and well-being, you have to do with the aspect. And so I was talking to Jamie the other day. She says, well, Pastor Bam, what do you want me to share? There's a direction you're going in. And I said, well, what's been on my heart is what happens to the nurturer when the nurturer doesn't know how to stop nurturing and help herself. Because women are such nurturers.
Call it superwoman syndrome.
The superwoman syndrome.
Black women really have that.
Yes, we have. Yeah. Here I come to save the day. Oh, Lord, help me. Yeah.
And yeah, I tell people, you have an option. You can keep going and not taking care of yourself. Yeah. Either your body's going to shut down or something's going to happen to cause you to have a mental breakdown and then you have no choice. So you can choose to and we can pace it out or you can wait until that time comes. Either way is going to come. So
knowing when to get out of a relationship, knowing when to break that soul tie, knowing when to. I remember I had some girlfriends. Well, I've been in the ministry. You ask her what was the challenge. One of my biggest challenges in ministry when I started off 40-something years ago is what women were not allowed to do. It seems like I was doing things that I wasn't supposed to do. I wasn't allowed to do.
Being the pastor is a male-dominated field.
Not just the pastor, but the founding pastor. Okay. So, and it's still pretty male-dominated. And the brethren love me. You know, they love me somewhat. They're not going to let me loose in their pulpit, you know, because a lot of them don't want their women free. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Not truly free, and I'll say that they'll be upset with me. Mm-hmm. I don't care. But I'm saying that because women need to hear that you're free. I'm not telling every woman to go out and start a church. I'm just saying be the best you can be. Mm-hmm. You can recognize that God, you know, in your understanding and perception of God, that God is not a chauvinist, that God, you're not a second thought in God's mm-hmm. eye, that the priesthood has changed, that women are priests now just as well as men, and there are things that women need to know about ourselves biblically and spiritually. And so that's why I like that foundation where I can integrate that in with other things, you know. And so I think that the thoughts and how you feel about yourself, low self-esteem, this body morphic that women are going through now, where even women of color are getting butt implants and lip implants and cheek implants and all that type of thing.
And what kind of mental health is that?
It is serious, you know. Mm-hmm. Especially, we are beautiful people. Look at her. Mm-hmm. Look at me.
Thank you.
Look at us. That's what real. I'm saying is, right. is how you see yourself. We have to help our young girls mm-hmm. see that they're beautiful.
But we live in a society where, especially with the younger generation, where a lot of their image, body image, and their sense of self is all through social media.
It is.
So they're creating, there's this disconnect with who you truly are.
Yeah.
There's a disconnect with your own self. See, they create who they want to be mm-hmm. on social media, but the moment the phone's off or you can't get on, there's no sense of self. There's no sense of awareness. You're interacting through internet chatting and all this stuff, but how do you choose the right person in healthy relationships? How do you go on and be as successful as you can be if you don't know your own worth, if everything mm-hmm. is based upon how many likes you get, if everything is based mm-hmm. upon how many views you have? And so it's become a society, external gratification, immediate gratification based society, and people are losing their sense of self. Mm-hmm. And I mean, not mm-hmm. just kids, adults.
Yeah, they are.
You know, adults, how many really.
How many are wrapped up in
that? They're living a fantasy. Mm-hmm. You know, talking about how many followers you have. I told some ladies one time, figure you don't have no followers. go read a book to your child.
Exactly.
Let's get back to reading books and mm-hmm. educating our children. Stop blaming everybody for what's going on. Mm-hmm. The system is broken. The mm-hmm. system is horrible. And we recognize that. But we have to do something within our own families and communities to try to fix that. And we can start right at home. It's the family.
I like the fact that you're open about saying that you went to family therapy. Because there are a lot of generational curses, if you want to call it. A lot of these unhealthy patterns that are being passed down from generation to generation to generation. Because, one, there's a stigma associated with therapy and mm-hmm. people aren't going. So for families to go in, if you realize that there is something happening in your family, always fighting, there always seems to be something going on, bring the whole family mm-hmm. in.
It becomes learned behavior.
Yeah, bring the whole family in, and if everybody's willing to do something different so it doesn't continue, then mm-hmm. then there's an opportunity to break some generational cycles that are happening.
Wow, I like that you said generational cycles and not generational curses.
I think that's important too.
I think that was really
when you
important.
You say that the sins of the father visit upon the sons, mm-hmm. even to the third and fourth generation. Mm-hmm. When we say that, that is dealing with generational influence, mm-hmm. generational behavior, more so than generational curses. But people will understand generational curses, mm-hmm. and they'll go from church to church, conference to conference, and they'll give money, they'll send in money to all these ministries to break curses off of them. And I think that that's something where the church has exploited the needs of the people, because you're not going to get the curse, if that's what you want to call it, mm-hmm. broken off of you by sending a donation. Now, God knows.
If I know some of those pastors don't want to hear that.
Send the donation. I'm not trying to interfere with his money, mm-hmm. but if you really care about the people, mm-hmm. you know, we wouldn't still keep doing this pimpish stuff mm-hmm. where people wow. pay to get mm-hmm. free. Mm-hmm. They don't need
because
to do that.
People, they don't have, there's a set of skills you have to learn.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Because I think I love conferences and churches. Great.
I do too. I'm having a conference.
But what do you do? You need to, what do you do when you go home? So when mm-hmm. church is over, when the conference is done, when you're at home by yourself at night and your thoughts are racing, or you're having flashbacks of that rape, when you're waking up from that nightmare, mm-hmm. when you can't turn your brain off, when you have this deep, deep sense of emptiness and it's so dark and you feel like you can't talk to nobody and nobody understands mm-hmm. you, what do you do then? Mm-hmm. And I think that's what therapy is about. Like those moments, mm-hmm. those, you know, everybody can put on a mask when they win anybody. You have all mm-hmm. these distractions, but you at some point you have to be by yourself. And you you take yourself with you wherever you go. So,
And I had a recent situation of a young girl, but I've had young men too. And there's a lot that young men go through and don't talk about. Men need men. And a lot of these young men, they don't talk about their pain because their uncles and the brothers on the street have told them, be strong, man, straighten up, man. You know, that type of thing. And if it looks like you're a whiner, you know, or if you're talking about your emotions, but then he's not considered a man. And I have one of my students last year committed suicide.
Wow.
And my daughter, who is also an artist, Punky G, who's going to be at the conference, she has a song or movement that deals with a fresh individuality so people can feel good about themselves. Mm-hmm. But this young girl didn't feel good about herself, but she committed suicide right there in her home with all her family there.
What about most recently, the 8-year-old that committed suicide? He hung himself and his mom found him, 8 years old.
8 years old.
And what was going on at 8 years old where you want to kill yourself?
And suicide is across the board. There is no shade, no color.
But you know what I found out recently, and you can check me on the statistics. I think that our mutual friend, Cheryl, she gave some statistics. Oh, it was another gentleman at the mental health conference recently that the suicide rate for black men is at the all-time high.
It is because it comes in different forms, because suicide isn't just, you know, cutting or a gunshot wound to the head, which men usually use more deadly means of committing suicide. But there's suicide by cop. There's people who put themselves in situations so they can get shot because they don't want to live anymore. So they create situations where things will happen to them.
Suicide by drugs.
Suicide by drugs, overdosing, or just putting yourself in all those risky situations. Those still count. It's not what we may think of suicide in terms of just, you know, the one.
And that means that there's something that's been going on with that person for a while.
But they feel like they can't talk to anyone.
They can't talk to anyone.
Because you're supposed to. I think that's you're supposed to. And then you can fill in a blank with whatever. You're supposed to be stronger than this. Yeah. You're supposed to know better. You're supposed to get through it. And
what it sounds like to me that when you go to therapy, you get the tools that you need to carry with you to be able to deal with it rather than just coping with it.
But it's work.
You know, you got to be willing to put the work in.
You have to. Yes, I tell
you. You got to want to get better.
Therapists will also give you homework. Sometimes they give you assignments to read. I mean, there are things that they will give you tools, and you have to follow through on the things that they've told you to do.
Thank you for saying. I'm glad you said it and I didn't. But I always tell people, my clients hate it. I'm actually going to get a sign and put it in my file. I put appreciate the process.
Yeah,
I hate the process. I say appreciate the process. It's all about the process. It sucks right now. Like, I'm telling you, it's going to be. And I tell people when they first come in, because we're talking about the benefits, but let me talk about the risk of therapy. I tell people all the time, there are going to be times you don't want to come. There are going to be times you come in, and sometimes you may leave heavier than you felt when you came in. But what I can guarantee is if you stick with it, come even. I don't care if you come in and sit on my couch and say, I really don't feel like being here. That is, at least you're there. And you can figure that out.
So when I went through therapy, it wasn't appreciate the process. It was trust the process.
Okay.
Because I had a real, real anger. I was a terror out here. And by going to just getting help and getting through that, it just put me in a whole other place. It saved me from the penitentiary or probably just a life of oppression. Because when you're angry all the time, you really oppress yourself. You know what I mean? When you're going through this and going through that and you don't go get help for it and get your mind right, it's hard to get your goals, the things you want to get accomplished. It's hard to have good relationships. It's even hard to love yourself. You know, so going to get help, you guys out there, was a good thing.
And when you
it's a part of my success now.
A lot of young men that are so angry, that's a lot of unresolved pain. See, because anger is a secondary emotion. The first one was pain. See, you were in pain. And so if we don't come to grips with why it's a pain, is it that my father wasn't there?
Exactly.
My mother's boyfriend, and I don't know where we lived, ashamed of my clothes. You know, right now we're living in, I guess, $425 tennis shoes now. You know what I mean? So now something else for our community to strive for, which is a know-nothing, striving for material things. And I'm not against material things. Like, God has blessed me with plenty of them. But when that is your focus at 14 years old, that you define yourself based based upon the kind of shoes you're wearing, or you define yourself based upon this, that, and the other, that means that we have really missed it in our communities. And I think with that anger, we have anger management. In fact, one of the first meetings we had at the church years ago was we had an anger management seminar for the young people, for the kids. And I remember we had two psychologists there. We were really new at this. So the psychologists were there, and it was dealing with, you know, our aspect of it was take it. You know, some of it you just have to take it. And then when the parents got up, the psychologist saw that the parents were more angry than the children. And no wonder
exactly.
So angry. The parents were like on a zero scale of
daddy's
zero
mad
to
at the
10.
Mama, mama's mad at the daddy.
Those parents got up there in the microphone and they were unbelievable. Mm-hmm. And I think the psychologist had to go in the room and regroup.
That is where the is where we get it from. It's learned behavior.
Learned behavior. I call it the spoken and unspoken rules of the household, right? So the spoken rules is what we learn in our house when they say, you know, come home at this time, do your homework, don't hit your brother and your sister, the things that are spoken. The unspoken rules is what we learn by the behaviors that happen in the house. So what happens when mom and dad argue? Does dad leave for 3 days? And that's how you learn how to deal with anger. Does dad scream or mom scream to the top of her lungs? You know, how does the family deal with serious issues? Does everybody come in the living room and talk about it? Or is it just everybody know that so-and-so has a drug problem and everyone acts like it doesn't exist? So basically, those are those unspoken rules. The if you're angry, you leave. You know, when something serious happens, don't talk about it. And we have to be aware of those, because that's what continues to perpetuate those generational cycles.
And along with those other areas, because like I was in the home when I was molested by a family member. So those are secrets, those dark secrets in families. You don't talk about it. So I didn't talk about it for years because I just didn't tell anybody. I didn't tell my mother. I didn't tell my sisters. I didn't tell my brother. I didn't tell anyone except for my husband when I got married. You know, then I began to trust and open up and tell someone. But I minister and talk to a lot of people, men and women, who have been molested, and they've carried that for 20 years, 30 years, some of them, and have never been, if I could say this in quotes, normal, you know, sexually, didn't understand their sexuality, didn't understand their sensuality, didn't understand why they were they were driven to do certain things, their behaviors, the promiscuity, the fear, all the anxiety associated with how I'd look and all that. And so we go through all those traumas, and we don't know what to do with them. Just God's grace kept me. That's the only thing I can say, because I've gone through a lot, and that's part of the catalyst for what I do, what I do, because I don't I don't get paid for doing this. You know, I mean, this is not a money-making thing for me, and if anything, I try to put as much into it as I can so people can be a part of it. That's why I'm doing the conference June 1st through 3rd in San Diego, at the Hilton Resort and Spa. And so if anyone's interested, they can just go to my website, bamcm.org.
And tell them how to get tickets. It's a number
bamcm.org. They can go to my website. It'll connect them to the company website, and they can register that way. Or they could call my office at 310-863-1907.
There you go.
That's not the number. That's not the number. I have so many numbers. Wait a minute. Let me give you this one. 310-330-4700 is our corporate office.
Okay.
And they could call that, because we're so close to the conference that it's best if they call directly to my office and talk to one of my assistants.
And that is going to be a great event. I read everything on it. That's going to be great.
And it's, I'm calling it an empowerment vacation, because it's at a resort. I mean, right there on the ocean, jet skis, pools, spa, saunas. And I'm not crowding the women's day with seminars all day long. And so you're so wired, you go to 10 seminars, you can't even think. So I'm going to do those during the morning, and then they have the afternoons to, you know, to do some other, get a massage and do some other things and shop and
whatever. Self-care. Oh,
why? Exactly.
Self-care, yeah.
So when are you going to do a men's empowerment?
Well,
we might have to put that together.
Well, you know what?
We need to be on the beach too now.
I have
now.
Some pastors and some elders that are working on something for the men next month. They do it every year around Father's Day.
Okay.
They do a meeting. They haven't gone away for a 3-day one, but I would love to see the men do that.
I think that would be great.
A men's gathering is nothing more powerful than men coming together.
You see, I had to speak up for y'all out there. You know what I mean? And so, Mayumi, tell us about your practice in San Pedro. How to get in contact with you if they want to come see you and get some help.
Perfect. So my practice is located in San Pedro, California. The website is www.ecctsc.com. It's Epiphany Counseling, Epiphany Consulting, and Treatment Services.
I like that.
And we do individual counseling, we do couples counseling, family counseling, groups. We have a lot of groups. We have a teen girls group going on right now that's really, really amazing, and a parenting group that's happening right now that's really amazing. We're open 7 days a week, so there's no excuse. We do late appointments as late as 8 p.m.
Mm-hmm. And how do they contact you?
And they can call the office at 424-570-6955. Again, that's 570-6955. Put me on the spot.
That's what happens.
And I offer cyber therapy. So my office is in San Pedro. So if someone is located in LA or Westminster, somewhere further out, we can do cyber therapy online.
Exactly. If appropriate. So that's new.
That's something that's really new. Most insurances are getting into it. It's kind of like goes across the telemedicine portion where you can pay for therapy, but if someone maybe can't leave their home for a certain reason or transportation is an issue, we offer cyber therapy. So as long as they have a computer with an internet connection and a webcam, they're able to do it. And that's on a case-by-case basis, because depending upon the diagnosis and kind of what's happening, that may not be an option. The person may actually need to be in the office to lay eyes on them and see them. But depending on what's going on, that's definitely an option as well.
And we're working on IOP, intensive.
And we're working on intensive outpatient for substance abuse. Exactly. Yes, that's in the works. So keep us in your prayer.
Exactly.
it's going to happen.
It's a challenge, but we're working towards it.
Yes, that's right. And so what intensive outpatient services is, it's a step up. So someone who needs more assistance, maybe a little bit more symptomology is happening. It's 3 times a week for 2 to 4 hours a day, group therapy where we have skills, they're doing activities, and it's really specific for the substance abuse population and trauma population.
Well, that's wonderful.
To start that.
We started an outreach called Pathway, and that is what Pathway was for, substance abuse, alcohol, drugs, drug addiction. And there was an organization, I think it's still around, called Free and One, and the concept was that every day of the week, Monday through Friday or Saturday, that there was a location that a person could go and they could get that type of therapy and counseling, drug counseling. They could never, not one day of the week, they could be without it, because you know how important it is that they stay with it.
Because especially with substance abuse, because you use a substance to take away a feeling, right? Mm-hmm. You're using the substance to take away the dreams. You're self-medicating. And so it's important to have a replacement skill. And so,
girl, you know they're not doing that to self-medicate. You know that's They're gonna hit a little bit, get a little blunt. Now that we've legalized marijuana,
is legal.
So that could be a whole show.
Exactly. That's a whole nother show.
They don't even consider themselves Medicaid right now. It's just like,
they need to really understand what they're doing. I believe it's a gateway drug.
People disagree with me.
But you'll be amazed at how many teens I have come in my office that do it because of symptoms. Like for kids with ADHD, it's one of the top, because the reality of it is it does reduce.
Calm them down.
Yeah, exactly. So a lot of them do it because they're stressed out at home and society is glorified.
But look at this. You have a lot of people who have adult ADHD that has not gone diagnosed, but it's really, really detectable.
Because
I know people.
Everybody just go to therapy.
Everybody go to therapy.
You know, I have often said everybody needs to be in therapy.
I think everybody should go to it's an opportunity. It's healthy. For self-discovery. I mean, what's the worst that can happen? You walk out, learn some things about yourself, and have a different set of tools. What's the worst that can happen? So
not much. And it, more than likely, it's going to help a lot of us out there. Because as we know, a lot of our people go undiagnosed with mental health issues.
Yeah. And I think it's important to stay where you know your strength or your skills are. You know, she's a therapist. I'm a pastor. Some people consider themselves life coaches. Mm-hmm. I think sometimes we can do damage if we start getting into areas in these people's lives without the proper training. Or even for me as a minister, without the proper unction from God to do it. And I've watched people try to help people, and they were sincere. But by the time they yelled at them and screamed them and drug them down the steps, and you know, it was just too...
They made it worse.
The session was trauma. Mm-hmm. See, mm-hmm. and what I like about therapists is they sit back. They're so cool. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. They let you talk. Mm-hmm. They don't raise it. What's yours? Mine never raised his voice. He was just there. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, Pastor Bam, tell me such and such a thing. Tell me such a thing. How do you think about
you exactly.
know? But it cannot be a traumatized session, okay?
Yeah.
And we do have a residential detox too, Open Heart Recovery, www.openheartrecovery.com, 818-408-9761. We do it spiritually, mentally, physically, and financially fit. So we have the whole component here. You guys got some great information, some great, great self-help, and it's for real, you know? Mental Health Awareness Month. It is for real. And the show just happened to fall right before the end of the month. This is perfect.
What a way to close
it. And if they can look up NAMI, now I'm not with NAMI, but National Association of Mental Illness.
Okay.
They have classes, especially Urban NAMI. They have classes during the week that's free for families who've never dealt with mental illness before. They need understanding, and NAMI is a great class, a great organization to get involved with, and they will be a great support system and support team for you too.
Yeah. And if you want to get a therapist, those two sites that you gave us again?
Goodtherapy.org, www.goodtherapy.org, and www.psychologytoday.com to find a therapist in your area.
No excuses. If you're out there suffering, go get help.
Yes. Yes.
What? Taking a break?
It's 4 o'clock.
You want to take a break?
You want to take a break?
Yeah, take a break.
We'll take a break. It's actually time to go. We're going to pay some bills. I'm Mr. Vaughn, your host on Los Angeles Today on LA Talk Live, reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. We had two great, beautiful guests, Mayumi McKinley and Pastor Beverly Crawford. Epiphany. I had an epiphany today.
Hey, let's go.
Mental health. We out.
LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network, the original reality radio, crafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk. Stay tuned.